Hi, good evening. This is Dr. Alan Barnard. I'm CEO of Goldratt Research Labs, and it's a great honor to present to you our first application that has been submitted and approved by the Mac Apple Store. The application is asset maintenance supply chain simulation, something that has been developed for the maintenance depots that are typically involved in big maintenance programs for Department of Defense, airlines, etc. The purpose of the simulation is very simple. There are four rounds, and each round provides deeper insight into the system that you are managing. In round one, you will experience the performance that can be achieved if there is no demand or supply variability. This means, for example, that you are told by your customer, which could be an airline or Department of Defense agency or large truck contractor, that they will give you, say, 24 planes to maintain during the year. And each of these planes will come in for different types of maintenance jobs, each with different cycle times, etc. No demand variability means that those 24 planes arrive in a uniform pattern to a month. Every month, only two arrives. No supply variability means that when you are placing orders on your suppliers to supply you with the parts, there's no variability. If they quote you 30 days and you order in time, 30 days later the parts will arrive. It is using a push mode depot operation in round one, which is the perfect world maintenance environment, which is simply that as planes arrive, they immediately are released into the depot operations and work starts on them immediately. And also a very simple min-max replenishment or plus minimum order quantity policy is used to manage inventories of parts. In order to see the detailed settings, you can click on this show settings button, and that then provides you with a description of all the detailed settings for the specific simulation run. So we can see here that the model is built to for the maintenance of 100 assets. We are modeling only 100 critical parts that is used for the maintenance. You can specify failure rate at testing, the assets that failed testing, how long do I typically wait before they get repaired, what the modeling period is. We've selected 10 years, and we can select different random seeds in order to introduce different random variability into the simulation. In this main section here of the depot performance, you can see there are three different types of maintenance jobs. Some have a frequency of every 6 months, so every 6 months a plane would come in for the specific type of maintenance type one. This gives you the range of parts that are typically replaced during such a maintenance job, and the cycle times in days for disassembly, 1 to 3 days, inspection, assembly, testing, and then what the total process cycle time is and the range of variability. And the same for type two, which is every 24 months, and type three, which is every 36 months. There's a number of other parameters that you can also adjust that we'll get into maybe during a next video. So going back to this, round one is all about establishing a baseline to see what the performance of the system would be like if there was no demand or supply variability. So let's run round one. You'll see the 100 planes on the left-hand side here. And according to a random pattern, according to the job frequency, some of these planes come in. I'll slow it down. The speed controls is up in the top left-hand corner there. Say it's a job that requires 3 days. We've assigned very simple time buffers to them. So the first 10 days, they'll be in green. The next 10 days, they'll be in yellow. The last 10 days, they'll be in red. And if it takes longer than 30 days to complete, the plane will become black. You can see the color as the darker color moves the progress that are being made, and you can also see the number of crew that is available below each of these units, And if there's no crew here, it means that all the crew has been assigned already. So it's a way of spotting where there could be bottlenecks if you have areas where there's almost never crew standing idle waiting for planes to arrive. The number that's inside of the plane is indicating to you how many parts will be replaced on this plane or need to be repaired or replaced during repair and assembly. And when a plane arrives and one or more of those parts are missing, like this middle plane here, you can see that no progress can be made until those parts arrived. Only other thing that you might notice is that if there are more planes in a section than there are crew available, the crew will start multitasking. They'll work on one plane. At the end of the day, they'll switch to the next plane and start with that tomorrow. And of course, there's some lost time due to the switching costs. So let's run it in fast mode and see what the performance will be like over a period of 10 years. You'll notice in terms of fleet availability, it's around 72, 73%. That means that 73 out of the 100 planes, or 72 out of the 100 planes at any point in time, is available operationally. The throughput of this depot in terms of number of jobs per year is around 209. Supply chain performance is exceptionally good, simply because there's no variability in the supply part or the demand part. The cost per job is around $1 million. Due rate performance is exceptionally high, 99%, and the delay day analysis on average is around 26%, of which the majority is pure cycle time, which is the green portion. The other legend here, WFK, is waiting for full kit. That's how many days on average is lost because a plane would be waiting for parts to arrive. You can see it's very small, about 2 days. Waiting for crew is the number of days that are lost when planes are waiting for crew to arrive because of some bottleneck resource. You can see that's around 5 or 6 days. And then waiting in queue, which is waiting in front of the repair and assembly if there's no space to put a plane into an assembly bay. And waiting in backlog, WIB, is waiting here. If in later rounds we're going to control the WIP, then that shows us also how long planes are delayed because of that WIP control limit. So that's our baseline performance, and what we can now do is we can go back home and we can run round two. And the only difference between round one and round two: round one, perfect world maintenance, no variability. Round two, real world maintenance, real variability, both on the demand side and the supply side. On the demand side, it means that yes, you're going to get 24 planes a year, but three or four could arrive in 1 month and the next month nothing. And how will that impact your asset availability, your due rate performance, your turnaround times? And then also supply variability. Again, the average supply lead times would be the same as in round one, but this time there's variability, and still using the same push mode, depot operations and min-max replenishment. So let's run that simulation and see what's going to happen. I'll run it in fast mode. You'll see that much more blacks arriving, meaning that planes are continuously being delayed. There's quite big bottlenecks happening. Fleet availability is down substantially from 72 down to 58. That means in practice there's 14 planes out of operation, which the Air Force would have to rent in or simply not be able to meet the demand. Throughput is down from 209 down to 170. The cost per job, because of the lower throughput, is up by 20%, up to 1.2 million. And due date performance is down at 58%, and day analysis on the delays is up 67 days, up from about 26, 27 days, and that's why the performance is so poor. Now, you can imagine what happens if you were preparing your budget with an assumption of no variability on demand and supply, and this is what actually happens. You will always be over your budget in terms of the cost per job that you've committed to your customers, and your fleet availability will be absolutely shocking. So let's see if we can improve on this, keeping exactly the same demand and supply variability, but just changing the rules. And in this case, the only rules that we're changing is how work is managed inside of the depot. So we'd like to synchronize the work flow into the depot, and we're going to do just a few things. We're going to control the work in process so that when work arrives, not everything is released immediately into the maintenance depot. Secondly, we will monitor their buffer status, and if there is more than one plane waiting to be worked on and a crew has to decide, they will work on the one that is black and then red and then yellow and then green. Other two small changes is that no multitasking is allowed, that once a crew starts a plane, they have to complete it. And secondly, to enable that, they will not start work on a plane unless there's a full kit of all the parts available. So that's the only changes that we are making. Let's see if we can do a little bit better than the really bad performance in round two. So we can see from a fleet availability side, it looks like we're performing quite a bit better, up from 58% to around 65%, which is substantial. That's giving the Air Force or airline seven planes back that will be available for operations. Throughput is up from 170 to 188. Parts availability is still quite good, but unfortunately from time to time those 5% that's not available, even if there's just one part missing, you can't complete the plane and it will be stuck. Cost per job is down by about 10% to 1.1 million, which is a substantial saving, especially in budget constrained environments. Due date performance is up from 58 to 70%. Not world class yet, but certainly much improved on before. And the delay days analysis shows that we've shaved off more than 20 days on our turnaround time, which is no wonder that our asset availability has gone up. When we do look at the inventory plots, what we can see here is that we're still using min-max. We're not changing our target stock levels. So we do get substantial stockouts when there is demand, and that is contributing a little bit to the delays. So what we want to do is to see what if we change that as well. What if we implement this synchronization throughout the whole supply chain? So we provide even our suppliers also the priority of the parts that are being ordered. So if there's a plane that's red and it's waiting for part, immediately the supplier will be notified of that and they can expedite that part. And that we will dynamically change those target stock levels based on the real demand rather than forecasted demand. Let's see how close we can get to the perfect world maintenance scenario. And as you can see here, certainly much less blacks immediately. That's very obvious to see. Due date performance is much improved from 78% up to around 95-96%. Our fleet availability is getting very close to 70%, which is very close to perfect world maintenance. That again, from our baseline of 58%, that's giving 11 planes back to the airline or the Air Force. Our throughput is up very close to what we previously had of 209, it's 201 jobs. Parts availability is now 2.5% better, and that has cut even more time down from delayed days analysis. We're waiting less for parts, and when we look at those inventory plots, we can see how we are dynamically adjusting the buffers based on real demand. Yes, there are still stockouts, but we are reacting much faster to ensure those stockouts don't last very long, or that they don't affect planes that have that are already in priority red or black. So in summary, the simulation is a really good tool to be able to see why there is often such a gap between what is budgeted versus what actually happens. And normally it's because the budgets ignore the dynamic impact of variability in demand and supply. And lastly, we can see how much better we can do just by changing the rules. First of all, synchronizing the depot better using theory of constraints, critical chain project management rules. And then in round four, what will happen if we synchronize the whole supply chain, also using theory of constraints, dynamic buffer resizing rules. I really hope that you will give this a try. It's available in the App Store at the moment, the Mac App Store for desktops. And it is running on a very special price at the moment of only $29. So hope you download it.